This song's called The Hunter.
I'm not afraid to die.
ass. We're gonna do a song for you up our dysfunctional LP. This is a song about a friend of ours that got a little too high to fly. Almost watched myself fade away. I tried to fill my soul up with something that would ease the pain. So there's a lesson to be learned. Don't tap no needles, it won't take you there. Salvation on its way. Yeah. off our Tooth & Nail LP. Baby, not at all. It's been a long, cold winter, baby. Now that the tears are gone, even me alone. It's been long. can't sleep at night. It's so sad and lonely, sad and lonely. I'm alone again without. Sunshine, you are my sunflower, yeah. Girl, shit, huh? We're gonna do a song up for Heart Lobby Key LP for you. Goes like this.
Yeah. life is a mystery. Leaves me no consolation. Life fades like distant waves. Return again.
One, two.
Faded picture from your heart was all you left for me. I'm still waiting, standing here to see what I could see. Your love I borrowed just like time. It wasn't mine to keep, but the love we shared I thought was there. And now you have just walk away. There'll be no more tomorrow. Just walk away. You won't be there for me. From far away I tried to say I'm sorry, but I can't find a way. Just walk away. For I was blind, the hurt you had inside. I didn't mean to break your heart. I wished it had been mine. And as another day unfolds, don't know what it means. Was it love we had, or just gone bad? Still the love we need. Just walk away. There'll be no more tomorrow. Just walk away. You won't be there for me. From far away I tried to say I'm sorry, but I can't find a way. Just walk away. Still waiting, standing here, waiting for a sign. I didn't mean to break your heart. I wish it had been mine. Just walk away. There'll be no more tomorrow. Just walk away.
Just walk away.
set it all to rest. No one sees and no one wins the game of chance. I need to know, will the sun rise when it's over? Will the sun rise? Will there be a sky? Will the sun rise another day? A simple answer that all of us should see. Let things be what they may be. Open your eyes. You think that you're the best. Try to see the light before the final test. I need to know, will the sun rise when it's over? Will the sun rise? Will there be a sky? Will the sun rise another day? Will the sun rise another day? I wanna know. Will the sun rise on my soul today?
Or will it be a sky?
Will I open my eyes? Find my world is gone. Some fool has done me wrong. I need to know,
will the sun rise when it's over? Will the sun rise? Will there be a sky? Will sunrise when it's over? Will the sun rise? Will there be a sky? Will the sun rise another day? Will the sun rise? Will the sun rise?
I remember I was playing back in Hollywood, gosh, it was probably about 1979, and we were playing around the Hollywood circuit with like Quiet Riot and Van Halen and a whole bunch of other bands. And I remember this band called The Boys, and I thought they were a really great band, and that was Mick and George's band. They were from Sacramento.
I just met George, and I told him that if we were going to play together, he had to be pretty serious, you know? And he laughed and said, listen, I've never met anybody that was really that serious. You sure? You know, you're that serious? I said, sure, you know. So he moved to back down to L.A. and he wrote me some letters and said, listen, come on down. And
and an early version of Dokken was Bobby Blotzer and Juan Crucier from Rat. They were in Dokken. And we used to play with the boys quite a bit. And I always thought that Mick was a great drummer. So when Bobby and Juan had gone on and played with Rat, and I had gone on to Germany and got the record deal, I called Mick from Germany and said, hey, you know, do you want to, you know, come play in the band? And he said,
hey, this guy Don Dokken, remember that guy? Yeah, you know, he's over in Germany, man. He's got this record deal, you know, and Paris and all these songs, you know, and stuff that we're playing. You know. I said, I think we better join up with him, you know, and maybe get a piece of this on plastic, you know, because we believe that the songs could have done something. So, and it did, in spite of ourselves. So I go, he just wants me to play, so maybe I'll ask him if you can do it too.
And then he said, what about George? And I said, yeah, George is a great guitar player, but you know, I was kind of the guitar player at that time. And I said, I don't know, man. I mean, he's a great guitar player, but he seems a little bit crazy, you know? So I had reservations about that.
So I go, he just wants me to play, so maybe I'll ask him if you can do it too. And that was my fault.
This band has always been on the verge from day one of almost breaking up and never happening, so I guess we should be really grateful for the success we had, because my manager always said, you guys are successful.
In spite of ourselves.
One of the coolest things I remember in the beginning was driving down the road with Mick and hearing our song for the first time on the radio. That was a really cool thing to hear. It's definitely a highlight memory that I remember.
Don and I were riding around in this hot rod, one of the thousands of hot rods that he's had in his life. And our record just came out, man, and we were, let's go out and, you know, go do some PR for the band, you know, go out and raise hell.
Mick and I heard Breaking the Chains for the first time about a month after it came out, and that was a real cool thing.
Wow, it was just so, first time, you know. And so we pulled up next to this other, you know, like a some hot rod gray primered car next to us, full of teenage kids that had it blasting in their car. And we rolled the window down and looked over, and we were like going like, you know, yeah, yeah, you know. And they looked over at us like, yeah. We go, cool band. And they go, yeah. And they go, that's, we go, it's us, man. We're the band. We're the guys. We drove away, man. It was really cool. I thought that was so tough.
I think that Jeff is most fanatical in the band. That's a compliment to say that he's fanatical, but he definitely lives and breathes music. I'm pretty fanatical about my career and music, but he's definitely even more fanatical than myself. He definitely wakes up in the morning thinking about going straight to the studio.
It's unbelievable to me that I play music. I mean, it's funny because I keep flashing on seeing the Beatles on Ed Sullivan, you know, for the very first time. Of course, it must have been a rerun, because of course I'm not old enough to have seen it on TV the first time. I said to myself that day, I said, I'm going to be a musician. And I've actually done it, which blows my mind. I feel really fortunate that I can do this. It's just, I do. I still get the feeling when I play, when I pick up an instrument, when I go into a recording studio, I still get this exact same feeling I got as a kid doing it. And I mean, I love my work. I've got the greatest job on the planet. And you know, I've been supposedly acting recently, and this is a way better job, way better.
It was a problem toward the late 80s that the music became secondary, and that was a problem for Jeff, that he wanted to get back to just the most important things, which were music. And definitely the band got caught up in a lifestyle of girls and money, cars, swimming pools, going to the parties, hanging out with rock stars, all the stuff you say you're not going to get caught up in, but it's so easy to get caught up in that.
You know, I know for a while there I kind of lost touch with the things that mean a lot to me, and what means a lot to me is, you know, is the music, and it's about the music, it's not about the lifestyle, and I got caught up in the lifestyle for a while.
It was very, very strange, because when you first start dreaming about you know, you have this fantasy of being a rock star or famous and stuff like that. So then you set up all this stuff in your brain about how it's going to look, and, you know, these, what's going to look like when you're playing these enormous places and seeing your picture in magazines and crap like that. And all of a sudden, it seemed real easy, because that stuff started happening really fast for us. And fuck, the next thing you knew, you're living all your dreams that you had from 10 years old, you know, are starting to, you're living them.
If you take it seriously and if you get caught up in it, it does all the destructive things that you were afraid of. If you look at it as more just as opportunity and as things you can be grateful for, well then there's no harm done. Then it's just something, it's just an experience you're going through, and then you either make the best of it or you don't. I feel like I just feel so much more in touch with where I want to go and how to get there now than I ever did.
And luckily we had a chance to get back together and learn the hard lessons. So when Jeff and I got back together to write Dysfunctional, we definitely talked about it a long time, saying, let's try to make it music that prior to this time and stay out of the party scene and away from the alcohol and drugs and chicks and all that stuff. And if people call us and invite us to a party, let's pass. Let's just stay in the studio and write. It was obviously a big concern that, you know, anybody replacing George was a big concern with the band. George being such a great guitar player, no matter who we got to replace him, it was going to be a hard place to fill. I mean, George was one of the most brilliant guitar players to come out of the genre. He was up there with Eddie Van Halen and the Yngwie Malmsteens and all those kind of people. He had his own style, and you can hear George play for four bars, you know it's George Lynch. He has his own style. So replacing him was a very big issue of who to get. Everybody, it seems like, auditioned for the part to come and dock, and every guy that came said, I can do George. We didn't want him. So when Reb joined the band, he said, I don't do George. I just do Reb Beach. I have my own style, and I can do the solos, but I have my own style. So when he said, I don't do George Lynch, that was the best thing he could have said.
I actually had to think about it for a while before I accepted the gig, because I was worried that people would be, like, you know, throwing shoes at me and stuff because I wasn't George, you know. But I knew that my technique was so different than his that it would be really tough for people to compare us.
I think the differences between George and Reb is that, like any guitar player, everybody has their own style, and I think one of the reasons Reb got the gig in Dokken was that he came into the band saying that, you know, he respected George, and George is a great guitar player, but he had his own style, and he wasn't going to come into the band to copy George. He wanted to do his own thing, and that's what he wanted to do.
As a Dokken fan, I didn't want them to go in a different direction. You know, I guess stuff like that keeps you sounding fresh when you get a new guy in the band, or, you know, everyone grows up. I think just when people get older, their musical styles change with maturity.
When you take four heads and put them all in the same direction instead of fighting, I mean, you come up with something very strong.
We've been back together longer now than we were in the first time.
quite a bit longer.
Yeah,
That is good.
If you were talking about Doc and the band, like we're together for, like, you know, 10 years, I thought about it, we were together 5 years.
That's right.
5 years, five records.
Hey, it was a very...
Four records, right? One, two, three, four.
Four studios and
four
then
studios
Beast
and
East,
yeah. Yeah, we were only together 5 years.
That's right.
But we made a pretty good dent for 5 years. A huge dent for 5 years, I would say.
That's right. Well, set us up for this.
Yeah, I'm happy. Oh, I'm working for a living.
I'm real, real, real happy right now, you know? I mean, we got more to conquer, you know? I mean, that's one of the beautiful things.
We still haven't written, I guess, that definitive album. 9 hits out of 9 or 10, you know?
Yeah.
I wish we could do that, Sgt. Pepper meets the Metallica Black album, you know?
Maybe the next one.
That would be nice.
You know? I know we're gonna keep going until we get there.
I got inspiration ago. We just come up with like 10 songs that are completely mind-boggling, over the top, that everybody has to have it. They go hungry to buy that album.
That's right.
I could have paid my rent, but I had to have that new Dokken album. I'll buy something to eat later.
Speaking of hungry.
Yeah, I'm getting hungry. Let's go up on the pier.
It's smelling good up there. Cool. Wow. Young and Leon, we will say goodbye. Why am I still doing this? You know why? Because I still get the exact same thrill every time I pick up my instrument, every time I get in the studio, every time I work on songs. It's still the exact same exciting thrill it was when I was a kid. I mean, I love music. I've always loved music. Music is such an important spiritual part of my life. I mean, I can't imagine not doing it. I mean, if I didn't have music, I wouldn't be the same person. I really wouldn't. I mean, it's the driving force in my life, really. I mean, it's so hard to explain, you know. I mean,
it's not a job to me. I mean, every day I wake up and I think, I can't believe I'm paid to do this, you know? I mean, get up in front of 10,000 people and run around like a maniac and, you know, sing and play and write songs. I mean, it's a ridiculous gift, you know? It's a ridiculously wonderful gift.
Anyone who says they have no regrets in life isn't doing it right, man, because you have to be able to, you'd have to had your heart broken, you'd have to break a heart, you'd have to lie, you'd have to cheat, you'd have to be stolen from and cheated on and everything to get life living at its fullest, you know? If you didn't have any regrets, man, you just, that's just too safe. Well, when it's all behind me, I'll be 6 feet under. That's when the whole game's done.
Hopefully, when it's all over, we look back on our career, we'll have some fond memories of everything that happened. It definitely has been a long journey, an interesting one. Hope that our fans will remember us as a great band that's written some great songs, songs that will last years and years, long after the band Dokken is no longer.